Good afternoon, everyone. As I begin this assembly as your chaplain, I acknowledge that I too am a guest on the land of the Kaurna people. And I pay my respects to their elders past, present and emerging, and indeed to all Aboriginal people amongst us today. I have a prayer to begin this assembly, which I have on a slide for you, and you might note that it invites you to say the last line with me. The vision and hope of the Uniting Church is for the bringing together of all things, that people might not be divided but as one, that our differences might be embraced and celebrated, that creation itself might be healed, that peace might be our way. As we begin this special assembly today, let this be our prayer, and may we each say, let it begin with me. Amen.
Mani nina bodni nena gani yata na parnendi marwe changa ngal ko bukiana porkana ko magana mini yalana ngal wangendi mani nina bodni ngal ko yata na mani ngal tampendi ngal gani yata ngetikandi yati yata ngal patu william gata kandi yati yata rapat nama ngal ko bukiana mena tampenga. Welcome. On behalf of the Kaurna people, we welcome you to Kaurna country. On behalf of our elders, our ancestors, and other Kaurna people, we welcome you. It's good that we acknowledge country wherever we go, and the lands that we stand on is known as Batawilla, the swamp gum foliage place. And as you travel this country, recognise and respect our elders.
Welcome to Te Ati Wangatika Manka. Pronounced in the Kaurna language, this translates to truth-telling together. This is our truth about how South Australia was colonised, as told by the Kaurna Nation and the city of Holvas Bay. This story begins in 1836, when South Australia was colonised by the British. Colonisation means the action or process of settling among and establishing control over the Indigenous people of an area. Long before the British settled South Australia, the Kaurna lived along Adelaide's coastline and plains, from Cape Jervis on the Fluro Peninsula, all the way to Crystal Brook in the mid-north. They would spend the summer months camping at the beach. But that all changed when British colonists claimed the lands the Kaurna people lived on, without offering them treaty or compensation. This was despite clear instruction from the King of England that the Aboriginal population was to be recognised under the rule of law. This was detailed in the letters patent, which is one of South Australia's most important historical documents that still exists today. As we understand it today, Aboriginal history dates back around 65,000 years, when Aboriginal ancestors first occupied parts of northern Australia before spreading out across the continent. At the time of invasion, Aboriginal people had homes. They farmed the land, cared for crops, and traded happily with neighbouring territories. They were advancing with technologies, sharing language and oral traditions. In 1836, when the first of the South Australian Company's ships set sail to establish the province of South Australia, the Aboriginal population was around 15,000. Most of the British settlers arriving in South Australia had no idea about the conditions they would encounter. What do you think they saw as they set foot on the land for the first time? Were they hoping for a better life on the other side of the world? And how do you think the Kaurna people felt as they saw the ships arrive and these new people set foot on their land? On the 28th of December 1836, the proclamation ceremony was held at Glenelg's Old Gum Tree. Governor Hindmarsh read the proclamation document and reiterated the King's decree that was detailed in the letters patent. He warned the new settlers that they would be severely punished if they did not treat Aboriginal people in the same way they themselves wanted to be treated. But most settlers arrived in South Australia with a preconceived notion of Aboriginal people. Though the first few months were peaceful, and despite the orders from the King and Governor, Aboriginal people in South Australia suffered greatly. The colonisation of South Australia and the dispossession of Aboriginal Australians is rarely acknowledged in the history books. Few South Australians have heard of the letters patent. Even fewer would know what the document says. But these historical issues remain modern issues. Without resolution, they continue to cause great hurt and impact on Aboriginal Australians each day. We are in this together. We all have a responsibility on the path to truth and the path to reconciliation. And in the words of Garnet Elder Geoffrey Newchurch, once you start the journey with accepting each other's truths, accepting the truths of the past, then you start that journey of talking together, walking together.
Protocols for welcoming visitors to country have been a part of Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander culture for thousands of years. Despite the absence of fences or visible borders, Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander groups had clear boundaries separating their country from that of other groups. Crossing into another group's country required a request of permission to enter.
When entering was granted, the hosting group would welcome the visitors, offering them safe passage and protection over the spiritual being during the journey. While visitors were provided a safe passage, they also had to respect the protocols and rules of the landowner group while on their country.
Welcome to Reconciliation Assembly for 2020. My name is Maddie Rasmussen and I am from Jabiru.
And my name is Dina Warren and I'm from Unadatta.
The theme this year is We Are In This Together. The theme is resonating now in ways we could not have foreseen, but it reminds us whether in crisis or in reconciliation, we are all in this together. We take this opportunity to welcome our special guest, Marlon Motlop, who is a Larrakia Australian rules footballer. He played with Port Adelaide Football Club in the AFL, but is currently playing with Glenelg Football Club in the SANFL. He will share his story with us later on today.
We will now have Alyssa and Kane do acknowledgement to country.
We would like to acknowledge that the land we meet on today is the traditional land for the Kaurna people and that we respect their spiritual relationship with their country. We also acknowledge the Kaurna people as the traditional custodians of the Adelaide region and that their cultural and heritage beliefs are still as important to the Kaurna people today.
An acknowledgement of country is an opportunity for anyone to show respect for traditional owners and the continuing connection of Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples their country. It can be given by both non-Indigenous people and Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people. I would like to acknowledge the traditional owners of the land on which we meet today, the Kaurna people. I would also like to pay my respects to Elders past and present. Finally, I would like to welcome Marlon Motlop to our school and look forward to him speaking to us. Now, can we please welcome Maddie to the stage to share her story.
Good afternoon, esteemed visitors, Marlon Motlop, staff and fellow students. For those of you that don't know my name is Maddie Rasmussen. I'm an Aboriginal woman from Kaurna National Park in the Northern Territory. I'm from the Moorabool clan and speak the language Gunweka Gunjangi. Coming from a family who was heavily involved in connecting with our culture, I'm extremely proud of where I come from and the knowledge in which I obtained about my culture. In year 8, 2016, I began my journey at Westminster School, my new home away from home. It was here that I learnt the importance and value of one's cultural heritage and the relationship it shares with building one's identity. Being away from home made me realise that I had taken the environment in which I was brought up in for granted. In my younger years of living at home, it was normal for my family to practice cultural activities every weekend with my grandmother. She would teach me stories of her childhood and how she had walked through the land living off purely what it had to offer. She would teach me my language, how to read the seasons, and how to connect with my surroundings. Not only did I learn from her, but I was constantly surrounded by classmates communicating in a similar dialect, as well as cousins, brothers, aunties, uncles, and nieces and nephews who encouraged me to participate in speaking my language. However, after being at school for studying for more than half a year, every year I found it difficult to remind myself of these practices that I would take part in. My situation was exacerbated by the fact that I only had one family member in South Australia at the time. On top of this, I found it extremely challenging to transfer from a school that was predominantly Indigenous students to an urban school with a more diverse community. It was here when I first experienced people questioning my upbringing and the relationship that I have with my culture. Being an Aboriginal woman with a lighter complexion and blue eyes has led many people in my life to question my Aboriginality. This assumption occurs more frequently than some of you would imagine, and despite the innocence within the message when people say, "But your skin is so fair," they do not realise the impact that they are having on Aboriginal people being ashamed of the colour of their skin. Not only does this issue occur in light-skinned people, but it can come in all different forms and be offensive to all different cultures and nationalities. The theme this year in 2020 is "We're all in this together." Personally, I feel that this message encourages us to attempt at understanding each other's upbringings and backgrounds instead of building opinions on someone's culture. Being a part of a boarding community has taught me that by asking and speaking with new people about their homes, you are able to learn and further understand cultures that range across the country. So I encourage you all today to speak to new people, learn about each other, and build more awareness of cultures and nationalities throughout Westminster School.
And my name is Maddie.
We're here to talk to you about what our home means to us.
Hold on to me as we go, as we roll down some familiar road. And although this wave is stringing us along, just know you're not alone, 'cause I'm gonna make this place your home. Settle down, it'll all be clear. Don't pay no mind to the demons, they fill you with fear. The trouble in my dragon.
Located 240 kilometres east out of Darwin and is one of the most extraordinary destinations in the world.
Here in Kakadu, there's a variety of different languages, cultures and scenery.
Our home means everything to us. It's where our family has lived for generations and will continue to do so.
Our Aboriginal background allows us to connect closely with the land and appreciate what it has to offer.
We are proud to say that we are both from the Murrumbul clan and speak Gunlinku.
In Kakadu, our family spends the majority of their time out on land, learning and teaching culture activities. Our weekends mostly include activities that bring the family together, the list of these things, and then writing.
Our favourite ways of connecting with our family is through traditional weaving, fishing, hunting, and swimming. The knowledge in which our older family members hold, we find extremely precious and close to our hearts.
We ask some of our family members what their homes mean to them, and this is what they have to say.
But being connected to everywhere around us in a way that's a lot more than just physical, connecting with animals and just the entire spiritual vibe of the place.
Home is important to me because it teaches you about yourself, who you are, where you fit in the world, and how to treat others.
The important thing is to go fishing, hunting, and look after the country, birding and all that.
Home to me is everything, very important. Look after the land, look after the country, teach the kids culture, language, songlines, dance, home is our kingdom, it's our freedom for everybody to enjoy.
Thank you. I'd like you to welcome our guest speaker, Marlon Motlop, to the stage. Please give him a round of applause.
Good afternoon, everyone. I didn't realise there were so many people in here until I'm up here. Before I start, I'd just like to acknowledge the traditional lands we meet on, the traditional lands of the Kaurna people, and pay my respects to the elders, past, present, and also emerging elders and leaders within our community today, and also extend my respects to any Aboriginal or Torres Strait Islander people in the room today. I think it's a super important protocol that we continue to deliver within all aspects of our life and embedded in all aspects of our life as well, either acknowledging or welcoming, being welcome to country. And it's great to see such a prestigious school really embedding it in everything they do. So in terms of myself, I'm originally from Darwin in the Northern Territory. I kind of feel at home because there's a lot of NT people here in the room today. So special shout out to you girls and any boys who are from NT. So I was born and bred in Darwin. In terms of my Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander heritage, my mother is an Aboriginal woman from the Paperbark Plains of the Finnish River area. They're known as the Kornarikan people. My father is a Larrakia man from the Darwin City area. We're the traditional owners of the Darwin area and surrounding rural areas, and also across into a place across the harbour in which we call the Kenby. Kenby meaning didgeridoo in our language, or yiraki in our language, but that's from a Western point of view, from an English point of view. The Kenby is the Cox Peninsula area in the Northern Territory. My Torres Strait Islander heritage comes from my father's side. My grandfather was born on Thursday Island in the Torres Strait. He lived there till the age of 1920 and relocated to Australia, mainland Australia, to seek employment opportunities. And he moved to Darwin where he met my Larrakia grandmother, and that's how I ended up a Darwin lad. So I have very strong ties to all three of those different language groups and different countries in terms of my culture. And you know, this year's made it quite difficult to be able to return back to country and continue those connections. And seeing, you know, videos of, you know, the escarpment in Kakadu National Park, seeing, you know, the country near Jabiru, makes you really miss home, but makes you appreciate just how lucky we are as Aboriginal people, but also how lucky you guys are as our, you know, non-Aboriginal brothers and sisters to have that in your own country as well. In terms of my upbringing and my aspirations as a young person, I really, really, really wanted to play AFL football from an early age. I was born into a sporting family. On my father's side, they were either footballers or football coaches. And on my mother's side, they were either principals or teachers. So I was either going to be one or the other. I'll be honest, I didn't do great at school. So it took me a bit to get into university. I'm there now, but that's 20 years later. So I went the other path and stuck with my footy. And I was lucky enough to transition to the AFL level and play at Port Adelaide Football Club for 5 years. Living out a dream as a young 17-year-old boy in the AFL system is pretty daunting, particularly as a young Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander boy surrounded by, you know, non-Aboriginal people and unfamiliar people. As Aboriginal people and families, we're surrounded by familiar faces, we're surrounded by our kin or our family, or we're surrounded by extended family as well, or family friends who we pretty much call family. That's why we've got a lot of aunties and uncles, if you know us well enough. So. You know, coming down to Adelaide and being, you know, drafted and stepping into a, you know, a world-class facility, you know, looking at people like Warren Treadray, Chad Corns, Kane Corns, Mark Williams was pretty daunting. And in all honesty, it took me a lot to be able to express my true self, express where I come from, you know, and it didn't take, it took me until probably I was in my last year till I was actually really comfortable in myself to be able to express who I was as a young Larrakia, Thursday Island boy in Adelaide City itself. And I guess now on my pathway into employment, and as I'm still playing within my football club at Glenelg Footy Club, that's become second nature to me, is that regardless of what arena or what environment that I step into as an Aboriginal person, I share that story with my colleagues, with my friends, with my extended family, with my non-Aboriginal family. I tell them who I am, and I tell them where I come from. I think the special thing about our country is that we have the oldest living culture in it. I think the one part that is challenging for us is that prior up until now, we haven't had a lot of education on exactly where we come from, and we haven't had a real in-depth look and real in-depth opportunity at being educated on Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander culture, particularly for our mums and dads who went through high school and primary school and didn't have that opportunity. So as Aboriginal people in this world today, I think that, you know, being part of the oldest living culture in the world brings forward a responsibility and a role that we play amongst our society today to be able to educate our peers, educate our staff members, and as students, educate your teachers, your principals, because the biggest thing that I've learned today is that everyone is super keen to learn who you are and where you're from. And you need to be able to express that point of difference, express who you are in the right manner, and the way you do that is through getting to know each other, building relationships and sharing your story, and you can do it through many ways. You can do it through painting, like our brother boy up here, or you can do it through video, or you can do it through singing, or you can just do it through simply by talking and getting to know someone. So, you know, I feel very proud to be able to step into such a prestigious environment like Westminster here and see Aboriginal culture, Aboriginal people at the forefront of a lot of the stuff you're doing here. And as you know, I'm getting a little bit older now, 30 years old, so as an Aboriginal, a 30-year-old Aboriginal man, I see a lot of growth, and I see a prosperous future for not only myself, but for our future leaders sitting amongst this cohort today. So I thank you for your time today. I hope I didn't bore you too much, but once again, you're doing a magnificent job, and I think the only way our young Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander leaders can truly express themselves is if they feel safe enough to do that in a safe environment. And that's what their peers and that's what their teachers are providing here today. So you should all give yourselves a pat on the back and continue the work, because there's a lot of work to be done, but up until now you've done a great job. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Marlon, for taking the time to come and speak to us. There are lots of messages we can take out of your story, so thank you. I now invite the leaders of 2020 to come and give their pledge of commitment to reconciliation.
Pledge that our mateship is and always will be our enduring bond.
We pledge that our mateship is and will always be our enduring bond.
We pledge that we, as students of Westminster, pledge ourselves to forget differences of race, language, or religion and become united as one community.
We pledge that we, as students of Westminster, pledge ourselves to forget differences of race, language, or religion and become one.
We pledge to share our future and live in harmony.
We pledge to share our future and live in harmony.
We pledge ourselves to help others as we have been helped.
We pledge ourselves to help others as we have been helped.
We pledge for a united Westminster School that respects all values and provides justice and equity for all.
We pledge for a united Westminster School that respects all values and provides justice and equity for all.
Reconciliation is in a single moment or place in time. It's a lot of small, consistent steps which can lead to improvement in race relations. which in turn leads to greater equality and equity. One way of reconciling with the Kaurna people of the Adelaide Plains is by finding more about them and their history. Therefore, this is why we played the clip at the beginning. 2020 marks 20 years since 250,000 Australians walked across the Sydney Harbour Bridge and across all bridges in all capital cities and many other cities and towns around the country. The Reconciliation Bridge Walks marked a shift in our national consciousness, and 20 years later, more than 90% of Australians now support reconciliation, with 80% believing the importance of formal truth-telling processes.
Once we start the journey with accepting each other's truths, accepting the truths of the past, then we start the journey of talking together and working together. We hope you enjoyed this assembly and that are able to share somewhat of what you learned today with your families. Remember, we are all in this together.
A special thank you for Marlon for coming to talk to us today, and also Miss Edwards for helping us compile the music item, to all the student leadership group for supporting us with the pledge, and of course the tech crew for their efforts today with the presentations. We also would like to acknowledge all teaching and non-teaching staff for their ongoing support. Thank you all very much. You may now move out quietly.
I'm